हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग. गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. हाँ, मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. या गुड मॉर्निंग उपकार. गुड
गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
जो फर्स्ट लेक्चर इज ओवर.
यस सर.
यस उपकार.
हाँ यस सर.
नौकरी है ज्वाइन डेट. व्हाट वाज दैट लेक्चर मैच और कितना
एमओएम
मैडम.
सर. हाँ यस सर. क्या क्लास टीचर रुपये.
तो अंडरस्टैंडिंग दिस मैन्युफैक्चरिंग प्रोसेस.
हाँ यस सर.
मी पण लास्ट टाइम तेच मी तर लास्ट टाइम फक्त नाव लिहिलेलं आणि स्टेटस काय करेल तेवढं.
हॅलो उपकार, व्हॉट इज द प्रॉब्लेम? आय एम ट्राइंग टू कॉल साहिल.
सर दादा डोंट नो सर.
कॅन यू जस्ट पुट इट ऑन अ ग्रुप टू जॉईन?
सर यू ओनली पुट इट सर दॅट ऑल ऑफ यू जॉईन सर. आय थिंक दॅट विल वर्क सर.
ओके ओके थँक्यू.
Yes, sir.
Till then you can go through this, you can read this.
Yes, sir.
These are the links. There are the links for the thread rolling. I am going to upload this. I just prepared yesterday night and I forgot to upload in the classroom. this is the link for the thread rolling, and this is the link for the gear hobbing and gear shaping. This gear hobbing and gear shaping, these are the methods of gear manufacturing. And here are some notes which will be useful for the thread rolling, because thread rolling is commonly asked. This question is commonly asked, thread rolling.
Yes, sir.
So this will be useful for preparation of 4 to 5 marks. And yesterday I was telling that PG diameter. This is how it will look like. This is a workpiece, and these are the two rolls. These are the two thread rolls, or it is also called as the thread die. This is a workpiece on which the threading is generated. What you have to remember that each of this thread die should match or should be the same as the pitch of the workpiece. Like suppose if this is M20 by 1.5, so the pitch is 1.5, this pitch also should be 1.5. See, you can see also clearly in the figure that, you know, threads are exactly matching. Threads are exactly matching. Workpiece thread and die thread, they are matching. This I was, you know, discussing yesterday, that this is what is called as the pitch diameter. This is your outside diameter. This is pitch diameter, and this is your minor diameter or the inside diameter. So when you are doing thread rolling, when you are going for the option of thread rolling, then you have to see that the workpiece diameter should be equal to the pitch diameter. Workpiece diameter should be equal to the pitch diameter. And after thread rolling, the material bulges out and you get outside diameter. So this is one important instruction that as an engineer you have to give it to your workers or to the staff. Lead and pitch is same, but generally we use lead, this lead term, when the threads are multi-start, when there is a multi-start threads. Multi-start threads means double start, triple start, four start. Generally, by default, the threads are single start. If it is not specified, it is single start. Single start means, suppose if the pitch is 2 mm and if it is a single start thread, then in one revolution, the nut will move by a distance of 2 mm. That is the meaning of single start. If it is double start, then in one revolution, the nut will move by a distance of 2 into 2, that is 4 mm. If it is triple start and if the pitch is 2 mm, then in one revolution of the nut, it will move by 2 into 3, 6 mm. So the advantage of multi-start thread is you get more axial movement in the same revolution. More axial, like suppose if it is a single start, then the nut will advance or the nut will move by 2 mm. If it is a triple start, the nut will move by 6 mm distance. 6 mm distance. And in case of multi-start, we don't use a term for the pitch, but we use a term for the lead. So lead is equal to number of start into pitch. Like suppose if the start is 3, if it is a triple start and if the pitch is 2 mm, then lead is equal to 2 into 3, that is equal to 6. So in case of multi-start thread, we have to consider lead and we are not going to consider the pitch. These are some advantages of the rolled threads. You get a good tensile strength and shear strength also improves. So these two pages are sufficient for 5 marks notes. It is more than sufficient. Let's go for something new now. I'll close this and I'll upload this when the lecture is over. Now we are into module 3. Into module 3, that is head cutting, gear cutting, and finishing process. So what we are going to discuss is now the gear cutting processes. Gear cutting processes. The gears will look like this. Show you this image so that first you understand what is gear is, how does the gear look like. Can you see this gear?
Yes, sir.
So now this gear is called as the helical gear. It's a helical gear, and this particular machine is gear hopping machine. Particular machine is a gear hopping machine. This is what is your cutter is, that is gear hob is this. And why it is called the helical gear? Because the teeth are inclined. Had it been straight, then it is called as the spur gear. Spur, S-P-U-R, spur gear. Since it is inclined, it is called the helical gear. Both are used for transmitting the motion between parallel shaft. Motion between parallel shaft. But the advantage of helical gear or spur gear is they are silent in operation. That is, they do not create noise. Unlike your spur gears. The spur gears are noisy, but the helical gears are noiseless. And that's why in cars, in the gearbox, automobiles, always helical gears are preferred. Always helical gears are preferred. This yellow color is the coating. This is called the gear hob or hobbing cutter. And this yellow color is nothing but the coating of titanium carbide. Because of this coating of titanium carbide, the life of the cutter increases. This particular machine is called as the gear hopping machine. This gear hopping machine in which this rotates, this gear hob also rotates. This keeps on rotating. This also keeps on rotating. And then gear hob is fed like this. It comes in like this. Then it traverses. And then again it retracts. So like that the motion is. Okay. So then this was your helical gear. This is again a simple gear. This is for the rack and pinion. For the rack and pinion gear. So this is a spur gear. The spur gear, and this is for the rack. The teeth are cut. Teeth are cut on a straight rectangular bar. See, usually you know now you have one gear here and another gear here. Okay, so both are rotating. So the axes are parallel, isn't it? In case of spur gear. Now here what happens? This is rotating and this is driver. This is rotating and this is driver. So as this rotates, this will start reciprocating. That means the advantage of this is the rotary motion is converted into reciprocating motion. And this particular mechanism is called as the rack and pinion mechanism. In this, rotary motion is converted into reciprocating motion, or even vice versa also. That is, reciprocating motion can be converted into rotary motion. That is also possible, but usually we always use rotary motion to we always convert rotary motion to reciprocating motion and not vice versa. So there are many mechanisms, like you can have piston and connecting rod. So in that, you know, the rotary motion of the crank or a rotary motion of the connecting rod is converted into reciprocating motion of the piston in case of cylinder. Then you have eccentric pin method also. In eccentric pin method also, rotary motion is converted into reciprocating. Then you have cam and cam follower. They're also same thing. So this is the most simplest out of these four what I discussed. So this is for the pinion and this is your rack.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then this is a mechanism. This is your gear shaping machine. This is your gear shaping machine. That is, if it is asked, then you can draw this sketch. This sketch is easy. So this gear shaping cutter means this cutter is rotating. Cutter is rotating at the same time it reciprocates up and down. And this is the gear blank. Gear blank means gear workpiece. Blank means always a workpiece which is going to be processed. So this is what is your gear blank is, on which the teeth are cut. With the teeth are cut. Now what are the different motion? The gear blank is rotating. Then cutter is also rotating. This and cutter reciprocates also. Cutter reciprocates also. Right. So this particular machine is called as the gear shaping machine. There are different methods to cut the gear. I just now I show you that was gear bobbing. This is your gear shaping. Your gear shaping. So what are the different motions here? That is what you have to identify first. That is, your gear blank is rotating, your shaping cutter is rotating, and shaping cutter reciprocates, and at the same time now your shaping cutter has to go inside also, isn't it? That is the depth of cut. That is the depth of cut, isn't it? So either you can take one depth of cut, like suppose if the depth of cut, that is the depth of the teeth, is suppose 3 mm, you can take one depth of cut, or you can take series of depth of cut, means it will go on feeding inside. So that motion is not here, but here it is assumed that it is taking a single cut, but usually doesn't happen. You have to take a series of depth of cut. Single cut means what? The load on the cutter will be very high, and there are chances that cutter may break. So this is what, you know, the principle of gear shaping machine. This is gear blank or the workpiece which is rotating, and then this is a cutter, a shaping cutter, which is moving up and down, and it is rotating also. See, this is rotary motion, and at the same time it feeds inside. I was telling you about the depth of cut, and as it rotates, this also rotates, and it goes on cutting the teeth. It goes on cutting the teeth. This internal mechanism you need not worry. Internal mechanism you need not worry. This is what is your gear hobbies. Gear cutter. These are the teeth, and this is for the flutes. The flutes, or it is also called as the gashes. This is used for any flutes. It is used for guiding the chips. So the chips can be removed. Chips can be removed. Again, I will show this is the principle of gear shaping. This is a gear shaping machine. This is your rack and pinion movement. This is your gear hopping machine. Then this is gear teeth grinding. Like suppose if you harden the gear, because most of the time gear hardening is required, because if the gear is soft, then it will wear off very faster. It will wear off very faster. So in order, and then life of the gear will be very less. So in order to avoid that, or in order to increase the life of the gear, we harden the gear teeth. Correct. And then once the gear teeth is hardened, then during hardening, what happens? There is small amount of distortion, as well as the surface also get oxidized. So in order to clean, we need to do gear teeth grinding. So gear teeth grinding, how does it happens? You have a abrasive grinding mill which is mounted on a spindle. This spindle is rotating, so therefore this grinding wheel will also rotate, and the shape of the grinding wheel means exactly matches the tooth space between the two gear teeth. This is your grinding wheel. The shape of the grinding wheel is formed as per the space of the gear teeth. Now this is rotating, and then you have to give the infeed like this. This is what is called the radial feed. You have to give the infeed like this, slowly, slowly, and it cuts. So that was your simple method of gear teeth grinding. This is how a typical gear hopping machine will look like. On this your gear teeth cutter is mounted, and on this your workpiece is mounted. There is a provision that it can move up and down, the provision that this will rotate, and this is rotating. The provision that workpiece table can be moved in this direction as well as in this direction. It's not much complicated, but that is not required. So this is the general image of your gear cutting machine. This is your gear teeth grinding, which is done after hardening the workpiece. This is the photograph of your gear cutting machine. This is a table on which your gear blank is mounted. Of course, this is a finished gear. This is rack and pinion. This is gear shaping machine. No need to show this internal arrangement. You can only concentrate on this much. Again, this is not required. This internal gearing arrangement is not required. And this is what your gear hobby look like. This is gear hobbing cutter, not gear shaping cutter. Gear shaping cutter looks differently. Now, if the gear hobbing, if it is asked, short note, there are 2-3 common questions that will be asked, like for 5 marks, explain gear hobbing, either in question number 1, compulsory me, or in question number 6. Most probably one question will come in question number 1, that is compulsory. So you cannot, keep this gear teeth cutting for option. So these are the two views. This is your gear blank and this is your gear hob. So if you look from this side view may, you will see this is a blank and this is a cutter. Alright, this is a blank and this is a cutter. Now this is your spindle on which your hob is mounted, and it is fed like this. Now this, either it can be a single cut or it can be multiple cuts. It can be single cut or it can be multiple cuts. In case of multiple single cut, now this is particularly a single cut. So hob has taken the entire depth of cut and it is moving like this, in this direction, isn't it? So the teeth is being generated across the height of the workpiece. The teeth are being generated across the height of the workpiece. That's why this is for the feed. Remember, the full depth of cut is given. Now, in case suppose if the full depth of cut is not given, then Suppose if this is 5 mm, then the cutter will come here. The cutter is initially it is here. It will take 1 mm depth of cut. Then it will go like this. Okay. Then it is returned to its home position, that is starting position. Again, it will take second cut, that is 2 mm. Then it will cut in feed. Then again, it will return to the. It will move up, return to the home position. Again, it will go down. Then third cut, and like this, so on. Remember, both the cutter as well as both are rotating, and there has to be some arrangement for feed in case of gear teeth cutting. Now, this is not important. This is actually gear teeth honing. Gear teeth honing is nothing but finishing. We will be studying gear teeth grinding. So, why? Because gear teeth grinding is common, but gear teeth honing is not common, because it is very expensive and it is very slow also. So, gear teeth honing is becoming slowly, it is becoming obsolete. Or rather, I will say that it has become obsolete itself. But you should only know that gear teeth honing is used for gear teeth finishing. Yeah, some machines are complicated. Now, what we discussed, that was only for cutting spur gears. Now, what this setup, what you are saying, that is for generating, or that is for cutting spiral gears. See, there are many types of gears, spur gears, then helical gears. Then you have bevel gears, then you have, you know, spiral bevel gears. So spiral bevel gears are the most complicated gears which are used in differential gearbox of the automobile. Spiral bevel gear are the most complicated. So this particular machine is for the spiral bevel gear. So there are so many linkages and there are so many mechanisms. You have X, you have Y, you have Z, you have, you know, this rotary, you have this rotary, so many rotary action. But spiral bevel gear generator is not there in the syllabus because it is very, very complex. This shows, once the gear teeth are hardened, then it can be finished with the help of a gear teeth grinding process, or with the help of a gear teeth honing process, or gear teeth lapping, or even gear teeth buffing. So this is what is gear teeth lapping process. See, again, these are becoming obsolete because nowadays what happens, we do gear shaving operation for finishing the gear teeth, or we do gear teeth grinding operation in order to finishing, because this gear teeth lapping or gear teeth honing, these are very slow processes. I mean, this gear teeth lapping, if I want to, you know, finish this gear of having say 40 teeth, it will take at least half an hour. Whereas if I go for gear teeth grinding, it will take around 15 minutes. And whereas if you go for gear teeth shaving, then it will take 5 minutes. So that's why we don't go for gear teeth lapping or gear teeth honing processes. Again, this is this diagram is for bevel gear generator. Again, it's very complex, spiral bevel gear generator. Again, I'm telling that spiral bevel gears are used in differential gearbox in automobile. See, this is how the spiral bevel gear will look like. This is also called as, typically it is called as the crown wheel and pinion. Crown. This is your crown wheel, and this is what is your pinion is. You should only know the application of crown wheel and pinion. How does it use crown wheel and what is it? See, we have seen spur gears are used for transmitting the drive between two parallel axes. Alright? But what happens if the axes are at 90 degree? Axis, that is say driver and driven, if they are at 90 degree, then your spur gear or your helical gear fails. So that time you have to use bevel gears. Now bevel gears are again classified into straight bevel gears and spiral bevel gears. So spiral, both are used for transmitting the drive at 90 degree. In case of straight teeth bevel gears, the teeth are straight. And in case of spiral bevel gears, the teeth are curved like this, as the diagram, see. These teeth are curved, so those are called as the spiral bevel gears. Those are called as the spiral bevel gears. Spiral bevel gears. So these are your spiral teeth. So your spiral teeth. Spiral teeth. So as you can observe, it is used for transmitting the drive between 90 degrees. So this is one axis and this is another axis at 90 degrees. This and this, they are at 90 degrees. It can be inclined to each other, not necessarily that it should be at 90 degrees. It can be at 45 degrees, it can be at 60 degrees, where spur gears cannot be used. So there you don't have option but to go for bevel gears. Now, see the height. The center of this shaft and center of this shaft, they are not into the same axis. They are not into the same axis. And this is what exactly the principle of differential gearbox is. In case of differential gearbox, that is in automobile, you have a propeller shaft and the drive from the propeller shaft is transmitted to the axle. And on the axle, the tires are mounted. Okay, so you have engine. In the automobile, then engine ke baad you have clutch, then after clutch you have gearbox, then after gearbox you have propeller shaft, a long propeller shaft, and then from the propeller shaft the motion is transmitted to the rear axle through differential gearbox. And remember, the height of the propeller shaft and the rear axle on which the tire wheels are mounted, they are not in the same plane. It is down. The rear axle is down. Alright. So the rear axle is mounted on this pinion. And this is what is your crown wheel is. This is what is your crown wheel. Hello? Yeah, Mantan. Hello, Mantan. Can I call you later? Because I am in the lecture. 11:10. Is it okay? It will go till 11:05. Online lectures are going on, no? Yeah, so this is what is called as the crown wheel and pinion arrangement. Crown wheel and pinion arrangement, which is used in the differential gearbox, and these are machined or these are cut on the bevel gear generator. These are cut on the bevel gear generator, right? And that is the most complicated machine in gear cutting. Even the racks are used for cutting the gear teeth. Even the racks are used for cutting the gear teeth. So rack is the simplest. The rack is the simplest gear teeth. Rack is the simplest gear teeth. So how is the motion? This is your workpiece blank. Alright. And this is what is your rack is, which is moving up and down, and it reciprocates also like this. The reciprocating motion. And it cuts the teeth. Alright. So this is the most simplest machine. So you should have a provision. This is the most simplest machine in which you should have a provision to rotate the gear blank, and you should have a provision to reciprocate the rack. That's all. So it is the most simplest. It is the most simplest gear cutting machine. This is your gear shaving machine. Gear shaving machine is used for finishing the gear. It's used for finishing the gear. So now here the gear is mounted. Means you have already cut the gear, and gear is reasonably hardened also. So that gear is mounted between center on a mandrel, and then you have a Harden gear. Harden gear, which is also called as the master gear. Okay. So the master gear is rotating positively. Master gear is rotating positively. Whereas this workpiece will not rotate positively. See, you can note that there are only centers. These are the only revolving centers. As this gear is rotating, this master gear is rotating, because of this, your workpiece will rotate, right? So this is fed down. This shaving cutter is fed down, and then it is moved across the length of the workpiece. And in just few rotations of the workpiece and the cutter, the workpiece is finished. Because since it is already cut, you don't have to take the series of cut one after other. Directly one cut can be taken. So the shaving cutter is fed directly till the depth of the workpiece. So in one, and then what it has to do, it has to simply the travel, it has to simply travel across the length of the workpiece. So that's why it is very fast. That's why it is very fast. And generally, the gear shaving machines are used for finishing the gear teeth. Gear shaving machines are used for finishing the gear teeth. Only you have to see here that this is same as your workpiece. Means the module of the gear shaving cutter should be same as the module of the workpiece blank. Module of the workpiece blank. All right. And gear shaving cutter is definitely harder. Definitely harder than your workpiece. Then only it can cut. This is how a typical cutter will look like. Gear cutter will look like. See, these are the gashes, or these are the serrations. This is a cutter, a round cutter. Only few teeth are shown here. Only few teeth are shown. Right? This is a cutter, and this is a blank. This is a blank. Remember, in gear cutting, whether you use gear hopping or gear shaping or gear shaving, whenever the two gears are matching, this is also gear like a gear, and this is also like a gear. But one is cutter and another is blank. The cutter will cut teeth on the blank. So remember, the module has to be same module. Like suppose if this is module 4, and then this also should be module 4. Module is nothing but the important parameter of the gear. Like you have been assigned your roll number. So with the help of a roll number, you understand all the details of the student. So similarly, the module is a parameter with the help of which you can understand the entire, kundali of the gear. So all the informations can be understood. And module is defined as M, symbolically represented as M, which is equal to pitch circle diameter upon number of teeth. Pitch circle, not outside diameter, pitch circle diameter upon number of teeth. So if the pitch circle diameter is 100, and if the number of teeth are 25, then module is equal to 100 divided by 25, that is 4. See, this is how your cutter will look like. Gear shaving cutter, which will be used for finishing the already cut gear. So this gear is mounted between center, and then you have a gear shaving cutter which is just pressed inside, and then both the rotates and the gear teeth are finished. Very fast process. That's why lapping, gear lapping, gear honing, gear, buffing are obsolete. And even gear teeth grinding is also becoming obsolete and obsolete. So these are the images which will be helpful for you to understand. So there are type of the gears, that is nothing but a spur gear, helical gear, bevel gear, then rack, then spiral bevel gear, then rack and pinion, that is this. But these complicated gears are not there in your syllabus. So we will concentrate on gear hopping and gear shaping. We will not go for this bevel gear generator. We will also not go for helical gears. Helical gears. We will not go for gear teeth finishing processes. In the syllabus, there are finishing, those finishing processes are different, that we will discuss later. Those finishing processes are not for the gear teeth finishing processes. Right? Okay. So, let's go for theory portion. Let's start with the gear hobbing, which is most important. So by now you understood that gear hobbing is used for cutting teeth. Gear hobbing is used for cutting teeth, in which your cutter rotates and in which your gear blank also rotates. Got it? So there are different type of hobbing process. This diagram you have to draw. This is very important gear hobbing. The weightage for this gear cutting will be again 5 to 7 months. 5 to 7 months. So here, this blank is rotating. Gear blank is rotating, and the cutter is rotating. This cutter is also rotating. Cutter is called as a hob. So the cutting starts here from down. The cutter is rotating, alright, and it goes up. Alright, it goes up. So if it is just a single cut, then it is finished very fast. If the multiple cuts are taken, then now it is moving from down to up. So that's why it is called the climb hobbing. So if it is taking series of cut, then let us assume that home position is here. This is the home position. So from here it comes, goes 1 mm inside, then cut like this. It comes here, then retracts rapidly, that is fast, and again comes down rapidly or fast to the home position. Then again goes rapidly. Okay. Second cut, so 2 mm, then again move slowly up, that is for the feed, that is for the axial feed. Okay, then again moves rapidly over here, then rapidly down to the home position, then again comes here, then 3 mm cut, and like that it cuts. Because 5 mm depth of cut is not possible. If you are taking 5 mm depth of cut, then you have to go very slow, you have to cut very slow. Instead of that, you take series of cuts, you know, and go very fast. Because I have told you the advantages of taking advantages of moving the cutter fast. If you are taking depth of cut, very large depth of cut, then what happens is a tremendous load on the machine spindle, and there are chances that your hob will, you know, or your workpiece or something will get damaged. It is something like, suppose if somebody is asked to carry 50 kg, you know, load on its head, and he has been asked to move by a distance of say 100 meters, then he has to walk very slow, very slow. Instead of that, what he'll do, that 50 kg per load, what he'll do, he'll divide it into 5, 10 kg, 10 kg, 10 kg, 10 kg. And then that will be a faster in completion of the work. It is something like, suppose if I ask you to do 10 assignments at one go, nahi nahi, mereko kal ka kal chahiye, all the 10 assignments, isn't it? So that will be, that is called as a loading. You will get loaded very fast. So instead of that, if I tell you no, don't do 10 assignments at a time. So do one assignment slowly, slowly, slowly. Take your time. So that will be, in that way, you can do faster also. You will not fall sick also. You will not fall sick means, like the machine will not fall sick. Means what? Machine will not get damaged. All right. So this is your climb hobby. And if the cutter is moved from top to down, then it is called the conventional hobby. So from bottom to up, climb milling, from top to down, it is conventional hobby.
Yes, okay, sir. So,
yeah. Then there is another method that is, so this was your actual hobby. Then this is another method that is called the radial hobby. Radial means along the radius, the cutter, that hob will be fed along the radius. Hob means it is cutting tool. Hob will be fed along the radius. So here blank is rotating, alright, and hob is pressed along. So here no motions like this, you know, like this, no motion like this. So this is fast. So it is kind of a plunge cutting, plunge. The cutter is, or the hob is moved, you know, it goes deep inside. And remember, both are rotating. Hob is also rotating and workpiece is also rotating. Okay, so you have axial hobbing, first method, in which you have climb hobbing and conventional hobbing. Conventional is also called the down. Then down hobbing. Then second method is your radial hobbing, that is this, in which the cutter is moved along the radius. And third is for the tangential hobbing. Now, tangential hobbing is not at all in use, in which the hob is moved across the tangent, or hob is moved tangentially across the blank. Hob is moved tangentially across the blank. That's why it is called the tangential hobbing. But this method is not used. This method is common. Again, this radial hobbing is also not much common. Radial hobbing is also not much common, right? So hobbing, axial hobbing, radial hobbing and tangential hobbing. In axial hobbing you have again climb hobbing and conventional hobbing. So you have a notes also, ready-made notes, and you have easy sketches also, you know, and this is important again from your examination point of view. What are the different types of hobbing? Explain anyone. And then you have advantages of gear hobbing. Gear hobbing can be used for spur, helical, worm and worm wheel easily. This is for the spur gears. Okay. In case of helical gear, the teeth are inclined. So in that case, your hob or your cutter has to be tilted. In order to get that helical teeth. And worm and worm wheel, I will tell you. Worm, right now you just remember that they have some special shape. Worm and worm wheel, they have some special teeth shape. Alright. And the purpose of this worm and worm wheel is to transmit the drive in 90 degree. And they are used for the reduction ratios is very high. Reduction ratio means 1:40, as high as 1:40. What do you mean by 1:40? Means if your driver is rotating at 200 rpm, which is mounted on the motor, if it is rotating at 200 rpm, then driven will rotate at 200 divided by 40, that is how much? 5, isn't it? And that is what is called as the very high reduction ratio. Very high reduction ratio. And that is the purpose of using worm and worm meal. So you can get very high reduction ratios. 1:40 or sometimes even 1:60 also. But 1:40 is more common.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And then gear hobbing is a rapid, it is economical, and it is highly productive process. Now the limitation is gear hobbing cannot be used for internal gears. Internal gear. Just recall the very first figure, the yellow. Internal gear. Now the hob diameter, generally the hob diameter itself is 50 mm. Because the hobs are mounted on a spindle, isn't it? Hobs are mounted on a spindle or on a shaft. So that shaft diameter itself is a 20 mm. It cannot be lesser. It cannot be lesser. Alright. So, if at all I want to do internal gear hobbing, then the ID should be more than 50 mm. Then what about if the ID is less than 50 mm? It is not possible, isn't it? So that is what the limitation is. And for that, we prefer, or for that, gear shaping is the alternative. No other alternative. So that's the limitation which is specified here, that gear hobbing cannot generate internal gears. Gear hobbing cannot generate internal gears. But it is overcome by many other advantages. Bevel gear generating is the most complicated. And bevel gear cutting machines are called as the bevel gear generators. It is again classified into straight bevel gear generators and spiral bevel gear generators. So this is what is your straight bevel gear generator is. This is what is a straight bevel gear generator, straight. And this is a gear blank, which is called as the bevel gear. It is at an angle, and this is what is your cutter is. See, this is at an angle. No, the spur gears cannot be used for transmitting the motion at an angle. Straight bevel gear generator itself is complicated. So you can imagine how complicated your spiral bevel gear generator. But we should know there is something, that machine which is called as the straight bevel gear generator, and there is a machine which is called as the spiral bevel gear generator, which are used for cutting the bevel gears. And bevel gears are used for transmitting the drive at 90 degree or at any angle. We say intersecting shaft, wherever the shafts are intersecting. If the shafts are parallel, they will not intersect. So if the shafts are not parallel, then you cannot use spur gear or you cannot use helical gear. So you have no option but to use bevel gears. You have no option but to use bevel gears. So that was your gear hobbing. And then you have gear shaping. Gear shaping. So again, there are two methods to cut. There are two methods to cut. This diagram I explained you. This was the top view. This was the top view. This is your gear shaping cutter. This is what is your gear shaping cutter is, and this is your gear blank. So both are rotating, and there is a radial feed. There is a radial feed, in feed. So this gear shaping cutter goes inside and it cuts the tin. At the same time, it reciprocates up and down in order to cover up the entire length. In order to cover up the entire length. And these gear shaping cutters, generally they are small, available in small in sizes. So gear shaping can be done for cutting internal teeth comfortably, because gear shaping cutters are available in the sizes of diameter 25 and up. Again, there will be limitation. That is, suppose if you want to cut internal gears having diameter 20, then you cannot do. Then you have to go for blanking, that is, you know, press tool operation. You'll understand that slowly, slowly. Okay, so there are gear shaping cutters. There are two types. What we discussed, what I showed you, that is for the rotary pinion type. That is this rotary pinion type, which you are familiar now. The blank is rotating, cutter is rotating, cutter moves up and down, and cutter goes inside also. Alright, so this is what is called as the axial field, and this is what is called as the rotary field. There is another method, that is called the rack method for cutting, in which the gear blank rotates, alright, and your rack reciprocates. So your the cutter is in the form of rack. The cutter reciprocates, as well as cutter moves inside in order to complete the depth of cut. Alright. So there are two methods in your gear shaping. So this also I will upload. So it has advantages and limitations also. Advantages, limitations as well. Gear shaping can be used for spur gear and for helical gear also, like your hobbing. Again, gear shaping we don't use for bevel gear. For the bevel gear, we go for specific bevel gear generator. Specific bevel gear generator, that is a special purpose machines, which are only used for machining the bevel gears. Alright. So today I showed you, you know, different gear models, right? Different gear images. If possible, you tell your colleagues. So these were those images I'll upload, and then we discussed, you know, gear hobbing, types of the gear hobbing, and then we discussed gear shaping as well. So in the next lecture, we'll discuss, you know, different gear manufacturing. So I hope it was clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
If you have any doubts, please ask.
No, sir.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. You are taking so much of interest. See, even if it is one student, I have to protect his interest, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Thanks for joining.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.
Syllabus is so vast, and the time is also limited, so it is difficult to cover up.
Yes, sir.
And luckily, because of this, actually online lectures, we can go little fast because there is no disturbance of the students. If it is face to face, no, there is always disturbance, last bench students. So instead of 60 minutes, we hardly get, you know, 45 minutes. Don't fall and disturbance. Here, the 60 minutes, we get 60 minutes and discontinuously talking. So our observation is that we can go, you know, we cover up more portion. Anyway, but the face-to-face, it is, you know, instant, we understand whether the students are, so there are advantages, face-to-face, for blackboard teaching.
Yes.
Anyway, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.